This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book Coming of Age, 1939 to 1946 by John Cox. Rumours of War. It was 1938, and the Spanish Civil War was still in progress. Germany was flexing her muscles, having effected an Anschluss with Austria, and having outmaneuvered Britain and France over the matter of Czechoslovakia. It was obvious that a war was coming, but Britain had allowed her forces and armaments to run down and was in no position to engage in one. At that time I was 20 years old and was working as a draughtsman in an engineering firm. I believe conscription had started, though I'm not certain exactly when, and there was always a possibility that my job would be classified as a reserved occupation. To this day, I don't know whether or not I would have been called up, because together with my school friend, I joined the Territorial Army. With war looming closer and closer, new units were being formed everywhere, and No. 2 Company of the 5th AA Divisional Signals was born at the Wayfarers Club on Worrell Road near the top of Black Boy Hill in Bristol. My friend and I had been very interested in radio or wireless, as it was called in those days, and it seemed to us that a signal unit would fit in well with our hobby. We might even be of some use to the Army. Many others had the same idea, especially employees of the post office, which was at that time the sole legal agency in Britain for all communications. So the recruiting hall was full of potential soldiers on the night we went to sound things out. Among the dozens there, we found many of our old school friends and some of the members of our church. We didn't join up that night, but thought things over for a day or two, saying nothing to our parents, who might have raised objections, then made a second trip to enlist. Some lads we knew were already commissioned, and were to interview us before we signed on the dotted line. Our commitment to the force obliged us to attend for drill on 2 nights a week, and to spend 2 weeks at camp each year. Our employers were compelled by law to give us the 2 weeks off from work with no penalties to start with. It was a case of the myopes leading the blind. True, there were a few ex-World War I veterans and others who had been members of their school cadet corps, but we could hardly be called a highly disciplined group. We didn't inquire too deeply into the nature of our duties, or what exactly we were getting ourselves into, but were content to let life unfold in its own way. After answering a few perfunctory questions, the swearing-in followed with our right hands on a Bible. Some jokers later told us that we were not really soldiers because we had been sworn in on a dictionary, but that was a tale I heard many, many times. Then came the issue of equipment. This was rather sparse, all of it being of World War I vintage or earlier: khaki tunics with brass buttons, drainpipe trousers, second-hand boots, and what seemed quite remarkable brown leather bandoliers for the 50 rounds of .303 ammunition with which we were never issued. Were we then to be cavalry? A tin hat, forage cap, webbing belt with bayonet frog, bayonet and scabbard completed our equipment, though later on we were given collar badges and brass letters to affix to our epaulettes proclaiming us to be Royal Signals. My parents, when told of my enlistment, had different reactions. Father said little, probably thinking of his experiences in World War I, but mother, who would not let me join the Boy Scouts or the school cadet corps because they were too militaristic, said, "You're a fool." At the time, I thought that was a bit hard, but 6 months into the war, and I had to admit she had a point. One or two with recent military experience gave us rifle drill with the 2 SMLE. Short model Lee Enfield rifles allocated to our unit, and we did a bit of marching and saluting. Our Colorado Captain Somerville told us that our saluting resembled that of a disgruntled taxi driver giving thanks for a small tip, but we did improve. After a few weeks of desultory drilling, we were told to report to the General Post Office in Small Street to get acquainted with teleprinters. Good, we thought. Now we'll get our hands on some electromechanical equipment and learn the inner workings of the Creed machines, only to be disappointed to find that the primary purpose of our being there was to learn to type. The Creed teleprinters were only capable of transmitting 66 words a minute, but this was academic because we didn't advance much beyond the hunt and peck stage. About this time, the regulations were changed somewhat. Our 2 weeks at camp were extended to 4 weeks, and I was due to go to Southsea Castle on September 3, 1939. I think it was about August 28 that the Territorial Army was embodied. That was their term for mobilization. At 4:30 a.m. Father was awakened from his slumber with a knock at the door, and Corporal Reg Pennell stood outside with the engine of his motorbike combination still running to tell me to get up to HQ right away. Then off he sped to awaken others. I dressed hurriedly, had a cup of tea and a bite, and then walked up to Worrell Road, walked because it was too early for the bus service to start its daily routine. When I got there, it was a bit of a shambles, really, with dozens of men milling around trying to sort themselves out and generally getting themselves organized. At about 9 a.m., I walked along to the end of Worrell Road to the bank of phone boxes then existing near the top of Blackboy Hill, and phoned my office to tell them that I would not be in that day, nor in the foreseeable future. That was a little prophetic, because I didn't return there to work for 6.5 years. In the first few days we learned a little of the setup. HQ was to be the gun operations room, the GOR from which the AW guns surrounding Bristol would be directed. Some of us would be GOR personnel, others would form the line section maintaining communications with the gun sites, while a few would be responsible for the quartermaster's stores and general clerical work. How many of us there were I can only guess, probably upwards of 200, because we also had to supply similar groups to our detachments at Plymouth and Portland. To get some experience of aircraft plotting, 6 of us, including me, were sent to the RAF at Filton, where we were housed in splendid isolation in an otherwise empty vast hangar. Daily we reported to the operations room, where we became acquainted with the strange jargon of the RAF, angels, bandits, red leader, tally-ho, and the like, as mock raids and interceptions were practiced. If we had been on duty for the night shift, we found sleep very hard to come by the next morning, because fighter planes were constantly taking off and landing. Even when they were stationary, their engines were ticking over. For some reason or other, there was an Avro Anson attached to the station that took off and landed periodically. It once caught fire as it landed, but the fire was quickly extinguished. Guard duties were carried out when I was there by members of the Gloucester Regiment, the Gloucesters, regulars, and we used to mingle with them in the canteen in our off-duty periods, being introduced to army songs that we joined in with gusto as a pianist accompanied us. As the beer flowed, the pianist was treated to the odd pint, and occasionally the lid of the piano was raised so that it could join in the jollity, and a pint poured over its strings to the shout of, "And one for the pianumber." Life was exciting. We were free from parental control, and we were on the verge of something big, though in the background there was this little niggle of apprehension about the future. Early on, my inadequacy as a teleprinter operator was discovered by an RAF corporal, whom I had last seen as a 13-year-old when he lived a couple of doors away from me, but only he and I knew. On September 3rd, the rumors of war changed to reality. I was in the canteen when the news came over the wireless that war had been declared on Germany, and in our ignorance we waited for the bombs to drop. But of course nothing really happened for a few months apart from the odd reconnaissance sortie. Winter was coming on, and we still didn't have greatcoats, though at great expense we had added swagger canes to our wardrobes to assist in our deportment and keep our hands out of our pockets. Something had to be done, so we were issued with dark blue greatcoats that had originally been destined for the Royal Navy or Air Raid Wardens. Gloves had not been issued either, so we used our own, and a right motley crew we looked when we appeared in public places: khaki uniforms, blue greatcoats, black boots, and brown leather gloves. Perhaps this would be a good time to mention that, as territorials, we were expected to supply some personal items of kit. If we provided boot brushes, hair brushes, comb, button stick, housewife, hussive, underclothes, and some other odds and sods to take with us to the annual camp, we would be rewarded with the magnificent sum of 10 shillings. Until 1942, I was never issued with a complete kit, but over that period I was given some replacements of personal items. We also changed our World War I uniforms for battle dress. We didn't lose our leather bandoliers, however, and we were supplied with the Royal Navy's black leather gaiters. We were still not sartorially attractive. Len tight, minus his milk float. But to get back to August 1938, the roundup of civilians who were now to be embodied was not without its humor. In the early hours of the morning, Reg Pennell happened to meet one of his flock in the Kingsdown area and told him of the situation. Len was on his rounds delivering milk. His milk float was of a new type, battery-driven at a walking pace. It allowed the roundsman to walk by its side, starting and stopping as necessary and obviating any muscular effort on his part. Len took his orders literally, left his milk float where it was in the road, went home, changed into his uniform and reported to HQ. Then he phoned his employer and told him where he could find the milk float, leaving it up to the employer to mollify all the irate customers. In December 1939, I returned from Filton to Worrell Road and for 3 months became a member of a Gore shift. We had no plotting table, but instead a map of Southeast England hung on one wall. We of course were Southwest, but I suppose that Southeast was better than nothing. Colored pins were used to mark the position of planes. Information on aircraft activity was given to us over a permanently manned phone line connected to No. 11 Fighter Group at Uxbridge, and the lucky man who was given the job of listening sat in the middle of the room on an office-type swivel chair wearing a telephonist's head and breast set, doing nothing but waiting. As soon as the ringing assailed his ears, he answered, "Bristol," and then yelled to the rest of the group, "Operations," at which they were supposed to get ready to relay any incoming information to the gun sites by phone. While I was there, I don't recall any plots coming from Uxbridge that concerned our area. The shout of "Operations" was also supposed to alert the gun control officer GCO of the Royal Artillery, who then stood by his wall map, colored pins at the ready, waiting to give some relevant information to the gun sites. However, this was the time of the phony war, and the boredom was considerable. My Gore shift, Worrell Road, 1940. I think it was in the early days, just after we were embodied, that we were given our medicals. It was a bit of a joke, really. A cursory once over with the stethoscope, and an eyesight test on a standard eye chart at a range of 5 or 6 feet. For a hearing test, the Mo stuck a pocket watch in my left ear. "Can you hear that?" "Yes," I replied, then in my right ear, "and that?" "Yes." "Okay." And I had passed. And apart from the time of my final discharge from the Army, when they were trying to make sure that I couldn't make any post-war claims for incapacity, and the times when I was discharged from hospital, that was the only medical examination I ever had. One possible advantage of being stationed in Bristol was that I could go home when I was not on duty, but home was a fourpenny bus ride from Worrell Road, and this double journey together with 10 Woodbine cigarettes cost me a day's allowance. I was getting 2 shillings a day, but was allotting 1 shilling a day to my mother, who incidentally never spent it but saved it up for my return. I usually went home after a night shift, and so was rather tired and not very good company. After a month or so of this routine, I decided that I would be better off away from Bristol and applied for a transfer to Plymouth. The war was not very old before the post office started to get concerned over the loss of some of their key personnel to the forces. It was one thing to have their employees playing at soldiers in their own time, but quite another matter to lose some of their qualified staff on a semi-permanent basis. So just before I went to Plymouth, an arrangement was made that allowed the post office to claim back all their employees who did not have an army trade. The army could see all their territorial signal units being drastically reduced and took swift action. In a blanket approach, army trade ratings were given to as many members of my company as possible, not only post office employees. I was called before Captain Somerville. "You are?" I identified myself. I believe you've been spending your drill nights at the post office, is that correct? Sa. I was now learning the lingo. On teleprinters? Sa. There was a short pause as he looked over the papers in front of him and then. You are now a teleprinter operator class 3. Dismiss. A smart salute, about turn, quick march, and I was out of the company office with an extra shilling a day, but there was now no way my employers could claim me back even if they wanted to. About this time, a new face appeared on the scene. A real live regular soldier, Sergeant Millen, an infantry regular, I believe, but from what regiment I don't know, and he was going to change us into an efficient military unit. He was always perfectly turned out, his uniform spotless, creased where it should be but otherwise creaseless. He was a disciplinarian, and he certainly made a difference to us, but one thing always intrigued me, his facial expression. I never saw him smile or laugh. In fact, I could never detect the slightest change in his expression that would denote any emotion. Later in the war, one believed he earned a commission. Perhaps he enjoyed life and had some fun, but one could never tell. I'm not certain how many vehicles made up our transport section. I know we had Morris and Austin utility vans, a 5-ton lorry, and some 30 hundredweight Bedford lorries whose gearboxes had a peculiar and distinctive whine. The Bedfords were usually the workhorses of the line section, while the utilities were the general runabouts used for work and pleasure. We had one officer, a major, who was overfond of his liquor. He used to frequent the Mauritania in Park Street. Late at night he would phone and in a slurred voice demand that a utility van and driver be sent to pick him up. This happened on many occasions, and one night when he arrived back at HQ, he staggered into the guard room and with a drawn handgun proceeded to hold up the guard. He was disarmed and a report made out. The sequel? I don't know, we didn't see him again. Originally we had all signed on for home service, but after the war started we were asked to agree to serve overseas. This we all did, signing to this effect. Looking back, I don't suppose it would have made any difference had we declined. After all, those who were conscripted were not given the choice, but it was a nice gesture on our parts. Having now become reasonably proficient in those military essentials, marching, saluting, and rifle drill, the next step was to go on a range and fire a few rounds. The nearest rifle range was at Bristol University, and a group of about 12 of us was taken there on a most unmilitary vehicle, a soft drinks lorry. This had no tailboard or sideboards to speak of, and we all stood up on the flat bed, the front row holding on to the back of the cab, and the rest holding on to each other. We made the double journey without losing anyone. The rifle range was indoors, and we fired .22 rimfire from a standard .303 rifle fitted with a Morris tube. I believe we only fired 10 rounds each, with moderate success, but that was the only time I fired a rifle until 1942. Plymouth. The journey down to Plymouth was the longest rail trip that I had ever taken alone, and I was eager and excited about it. I was traveling with all my kit, of course, and I was learning how to stow it without interfering with other passengers. As we pulled away to the southwest from Temple Meads Station, the familiar scenes around Bristol gave way to the flatter country of North Somerset, and later on to the red soil of Devon. At Plymouth North Road Station, I detrained, but I have no memory now of how I reached South Raglan Barracks in Devonport. The barracks were typically army, gray, Spartan, uninviting, and ugly. My spirits sank. I was allocated quarters in a small room, together with 6 or 8 others. Beds consisted of 3 bedboards on 2 low wooden trestles, augmented with 3 biscuits for comfort, and the whole ensemble was completed with 4 blankets. I was directed to join a gore team and shown the ropes, as it were. The gore was located on Mount Wise in the end room of Himoazy House. A large map of the southwest of England had been painted on an expanse of dark blue linoleum. This formed the plotting table in the center of the room. To one side, a dais accommodated the GCO and also the Naval Anti-Aircraft Liaison Officer, NAALO, for this was a combined operations room. We signalmen sat around the plotting table, waiting for something to happen. Assorted naval petty officers, Royal Artillery gunners, and bombardiers made up an 8-hour shift. As in Bristol, one signalman sat with a head and breast set, permanently connected to No. 11 fighter group at Uxbridge, and the routine was much the same. Those doing the plotting made up wooden blocks with plastic chips of letters and numbers to indicate the identity, size, and height of a particular plot adjacent to a colored arrow, green for friendly, red for hostile, showing the location and direction of the aircraft. This was quite an improvement on Bristol's colored pins. There was another improvement too. The post office-type switchboard was replaced by two wooden desk-mounted units, each fitted with 10 switches and indicator lights. Every switch and light combination was connected to a gun sight or a searchlight station, and any combination of sights could be called individually or simultaneously. Each sight acknowledged receipt of a message by pressing a button. This caused the appropriate light to glow in the gore. In this way, messages could be broadcast to all sites at once. Those sites whose lights did not glow were contacted again individually, and the message repeated. Frequently, in the heat of the moment, gunners would forget to acknowledge, causing some irritation, and on one occasion, an exasperated GCO ordered me to reprimand the miscreant. Having got the official blessing, I proceeded to do just that, translating his order into the vernacular most effectively. I was rewarded with most obsequious apologies, elevating my rank to that of sir. Later, I discovered that my correspondent was a major, outranking our GCO. Fortunately, he didn't know who I was. These tasks were performed in the RAF by WAAFs, and we were told from the beginning that we would be replaced eventually by the ATS, but by the time I left Plymouth in 1942, they still hadn't taken over. It was quite a boring job at times, and most of us hoped for something more challenging. The line section's work was a little better. They went out daily, running more lines and repairing those damaged in air raids. In our detachment, there was no establishment for a droughtsman, but the line section wanted a record of the routes of all their lines, and so I drifted into the job. Armed with a 1-inch-to-the-mile ordnance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.